Today is my birthday. And what is a better day than my birthday for a Q&A? That rhymes, that wasn't intended, but I don't care. Alright, so the first question for the Q&A is from one of our patrons. It's from Cubase Academy. He also runs a YouTube channel, so you might also want to check him out, mostly if you are commenting under my videos that I should use Cubase, because I think he uses Cubase and he can tell you much more about Cubase than I can. What are some of your favorite reference tracks and how do you AB? And of course, happy birthday. Thank you. He knew that, of course. My favorite reference tracks, well, my reference tracks always... they change throughout the years. I still really enjoy the album Random Access Memories from Daft Punk. I like the Beatles. I really like A Day in the Life as a reference. I like Toto. I'm a big fan of the seventh one, the album The Seventh One. And I also like the track Mindfields. For electronic music, I liked the stuff from Yellowclaw. I also like stuff from DJ Snake. In terms of AB comparisons, yeah, I simply make the AB comparison in the DAW. Reaper has got a feature to measure the loudness of two audio files, and I can also match them up that way. So what I simply do is I select both channels and press Shift S, which is binded to toggle solo. So it will change the solo of both. So it will change the you know what I mean. All right, let's move on to the questions underneath all of my other YouTube videos. Well, not all the questions, but I've selected a few. Christopher Jesperson commented, "I really liked your snake oil tape video. It makes me sad to think no more videos like that." It's a bit sad, but I explained it in the video you commented it on. That doesn't mean, however, that that the idea is fully out of my head. I'm thinking of a way to reinvent it in a bit kinder way. The thing is, I still want to make those videos, but I don't want to look like a complete asshole doing it. So until I have figured that one out, no snake oil videos. Alfredo Paris asks, "Please, can you explain how you build your custom EQ, please?" So double please, so now I have to do it. A good source to start is Gyref. Gyref.com, is it, I think? Well, if you Google Gyref Audio, you will get to the website of Jacob, and he's got a lot of information about building your own EQs and stuff, and that's a good source to start. Also, Group DIY has got some projects. PCBgrinder.com is a good website to check stuff around building your own stuff. For me, yeah, I'm not a channel like Luke Mum No Computer, which is a channel I just discovered, which I really like. But I'm not that kind of channel. I will do some audio electronics, but I think this will go a bit too much in depth for my channel and my viewers. Maybe in the future I will find a way to include it in the channel, but not for now. So those sources are good sources to learn more about electronics. Tom Vos asks, "Where do you buy your gear? I always buy it at Buckshop. Buckshop is a Dutch company, so it's easy for me to buy it over there. But I'm still not using Buckshop a lot. I also use Thomann for things that Buckshop doesn't have. And the most of my gear comes from eBay because it's all secondhand, because it isn't being manufactured anymore. So where do you buy your gear? Mostly on eBay. Next question from Mova Team. Let's skip the first part. "Relating to the videos about streaming, maybe for your next Q&A, do you have any idea why there are such huge differences in the loudness when you go through playlists, even if productions are from the same time and genre?" I actually have never experienced that. Make sure that the loudness normalization feature in Spotify is enabled in your Spotify and check it again. And if so, then there is a flaw in the loudness measuring algorithm, which isn't weird because it's still a computer calculating the loudness. And there are so many loopholes in that system that it doesn't really surprise me that there are still some loudness differences, mostly in old tracks, because the mainstream sound is always evolving. And I'm not sure if the algorithms were written for the older mainstream sound. DGLS Official says, "That was a Telefunken, not a Neumann," on my Neumann U47 video. It's very sad to see that many people commenting, saying that they know what microphone I'm having in my hands. And what is irritating me about that is that, well, first of all, there is a company called Telefunken Elektroakoestiek. They are making the U47 nowadays. We did have those in the studio as a demo, and we compared them to the real ones, and they aren't anything like the real U47. But the thing is, our U47s were built new old stock, as we call it. So there's a guy in Germany that did buy all the parts of the microphones from the Neumann factory when they closed the production line for the U47. So he's got like gigantic boxes full of all the different parts for the U47s. And the place where George bought the microphones is over there, and they were built specifically for him. So it's a new old stock microphone. So it first of all doesn't look old. It has got the original parts in it. I did screw it open once, and I did see how it looked like, and it wasn't anything like the new microphone. Also, the casing, the housing is a new housing. It's also the reason why it's so glossy. And they did that for radio frequency interference, just to make sure that we don't get that during recordings. It is an original microphone, and I also have to say to all the guys that think they know what microphone I'm having in my hands, that there are Neumann and Telefunken batched original U47s in the world. All the Neumann microphones were coming from the Telefunken production line. And it depended a bit on where you bought it, which batch it had, but it all was the same microphone. So the only difference is the new Telefunken Elektroakoestiek and the old originals. And we have 4 originals in Soundvision Studio. I say we because I work a lot with them. Next one is from George Mikkel. Show your timing correction tips, please. First thing I noticed. Yeah, I really want to show them, but I think it will be a bit boring video, so I need to figure out how to keep it, you know, also entertaining. It's really boring. Timing corrections is super boring. Erald Lacey, can you do a mixing house or techno video? Yes, I can, but I need a track. So go to ytstudio.com/mixfix to submit your track for a next mixfix, an upcoming mixfix. Kasper Bjerkhagen says, of course you can have the overhead mic play in the future. Yeah, of course. Of course, with a DeLorean, yeah. Marek Vosen asks, what do you think about top-down mixing? Is it a technique you use sometimes? I did it in the past on some studio projects. So top-down mixing is starting with the vocals and work back to the kick. So the different way around than normally when we're starting with the kick. And it's really interesting to do it because you will treat the kick different when you already have the rest of the mix set up already. I don't use it in the studio because it doesn't work for me. But on live situations, I do work in that way. So live broadcasting or live performance front of house mixing. I really never do monitors. I hate monitor mixing. I work in a way that I start with the vocal because the vocal is the most important thing, and the vocal is the first thing the audience will hear. If they will hear a clear vocal and the drums is a bit tucked away in the mix, the audience wouldn't notice that. If it was the other way around, if I would start with the drums and they couldn't hear the vocals, then the audience would notice it. So that's what I think of top-down mixing. I use it in live situations. Fiddlesticks Muziek. Can you answer me one simple question? I want to purchase a Motu 16A, best converter there is, to hook up all my synths and drum machines. Can I use the Ethernet connection to go from Motu 16A to my Mac? And that be it. No need for USB or Thunderbolt. I can use the Ethernet cable for my audio to and from the computer to interface right. AVB works only on AVB compatible Ethernet cards. On a Mac, every Mac with a Thunderbolt connection is AVB compatible. A Mac Pro needs a separated AVB compatible network card, and the best one to buy is the Sonnet Ethernet Pro card. The Ethernet card from Sonnet. There's also a card from Intel, but that one doesn't really work. If you have a Mac with Thunderbolt, I advise you to connect it over Thunderbolt, because Thunderbolt is even better than the AVB connection for a Mac. I don't know why, but they say it. I actually don't know why. Mika461983. Why the separator of the project is not the same as the separator of the files in the project, the eye icon, blah blah blah. So why do I use 48 kilohertz independent of the files I get? So it's actually from the old Pro Tools days. When running Pro Tools with a lot of interfaces, you don't want to change sample rate. It's a lot of work and a lot of headaches. And if you got it running stable at one sample rate, you just want to keep it there. So the thing is that I still keep it at 48 so that I never need to think about the sample rates when I'm working on it. I'm planning to go with a higher sample rate, but I'm still not ready for that. And I'm still very happy with 48 kilohertz, and I still have a few old projects running in 48 kilohertz. So I first want to do those before I go up to 96 or 192. Midnight Mix asks, what console is that? I'm new to this channel. He's talking about the Side console over here. It's a Side S3. That's the original name of it. It's from the company is called Side. They do make space satellites right now. They don't do anything anymore in the audio industry. I contacted them, they didn't reply. But you can compare it the best to a Kodak console. You know, back in the days when this console was built, all the schematics, all the techniques were, as they call it, open source. So everybody was using the techniques from every other. And this looks a bit like Kodak. It's not a full Kodak. Kodak is still better. It's the same way of thinking and the same, mostly the EQ is the same as a Kodak EQ. But it is a Side. It's a Side S3. Nurnwui asks, you're not using samples to enrich the drums, question mark. No, because that will take away the whole human thing of drumming from it. So I always try to do it with the sound I get. And when I'm recording, I really focus on mic positions. And also for drums, the tuning of the drum kit and the drum kit itself. That's way more important than the mix or whatever. If you need to use samples, you can better redo the recording or not record at all. Empire Leon Light ASMR says, honest to God, thought your car fell off a cliff, had a small heart attack. It's a Volvo. Even if it will fall down a cliff, you can still drive away with it afterwards. No, it doesn't really care about cliffs. TDave971, salut mon ami. So what is better, do the panning before to check the mix and mono or after? Thanks again for your great videos. I would say first do the panning and then check the mix in mono, because panning is also -3 decibels, or it depends a bit on your DAW, but there should be a panning law somewhere, a setting with panning law, and that you can set it to -2.5, -3, -4.5, -6, whatever. Because if you're panning it to one speaker, it needs to go down in volume a bit because it's only one speaker instead of two. You understand it. Thomas Holek asks, or says, I honestly don't understand how it is possible that you don't have more subs, views or patrons. Your content is amazing. I guess people don't care about the art of mixing as much as they do about clickbaity videos on how to make Skrillex sounds or whatever is popular at the time. So here's how I look at things like this. And this is also a tip for not only YouTube, but you know, doing business in general or growing as a person. Holy crap, who did ever expect that I would be talking about that in this Q&A? I grow some plants at home. It's not weed. I'm Dutch, but it's not weed. It's just, you know, what is it actually called? Mint. Mint is one of the plants because I like a mint tea. And that's a real fast-growing plant. The thing with mint is that it's not very steady. You cannot balance a book on it or something. You know, the plant will break and nothing. So it's a fast-growing plant, but yeah, it's cool to have in your tea, but you cannot do anything with it. If I had a backyard, I would grow a tree. And a tree will take way longer to grow, like really long to grow. But you can climb in it afterwards. It's really steady. It will have very big roots in the ground holding itself down. That's how I see doing or building a business and building a YouTube channel. When you have it growing slowly, it will also be more steady and it will have better roots. So let's just give it time and it will grow bigger than who else. And the only thing that I need to do, and also I advise you all to do, is don't stop. And moving on to the next question, which is a big contrast. Je va te dire, fucking noob, your videos are fucking useless. So Let's split this comment into two parts. The first part is a fucking noob. Yeah, I only have 7 years of experience, so I'm still a bit of a newbie in the industry. But yeah, you have to be a newbie to get started, so I don't know why you're angry about that. It seems like your comment is a bit angry. Your videos are fucking useless. I really don't understand that, because I make a video for people to view. That's the whole use case of a video. So he did view the video. So he did use it. So how can it be useless then? I don't understand him. Next one. Nurnwi. Hey, W. That's me. I got a question for you. Do you have any stories about engineers with tinnitus and how do they deal with it? Thanks. So it's very sad if you have tinnitus and you're in the audio engineering business. So I can advise you all to do everything to avoid it. Make sure you have earplugs. Make sure you don't turn up the control volume too high. Even limit your volume knob if you have the possibility. I don't know an engineer that has it, but what I would do if I would have it is really train my brain to not hear it anymore, and that would be very hard, very hard. I think I would be very sad in the beginning. Lars van der Hoofd. So how are those high frequencies related to us if we can only hear until 20 kilohertz? The frequencies are related to us when we are doing processing, like limiting processing. Those frequencies will make harmonics in the part that we can hear. So it's important to have them in the processing. We cannot hear them, but it's important that we can process them. So that's why that oversampling and a high sample rate is important. Graham Simpleton asks, or says, gain is way too hot coming in. Set your WAFs minus 14 dB all files before using simulations and read manuals. I've never read a manual. I'm not planning on reading one. If I need to read a manual, the thing is too complicated. I'm combining this question with the next one, which is test is not valid. Nobody ever flatpinned the view meters on tape machines and your OCD with analog looking plugins is fucking creepy. Just let it go. I don't know, but if you're using an analog tape machine, you better fry it, because otherwise, why are you using it? So pump up the most audio in it until it's going to fucking burn. That's how analog tape works, and that's what I'm expecting from a digital shitty plugin. Also, my OCD on analog looking plugins isn't creepy, it's my passion. Analog is my passion, and people pretending to make in software what I like from analog equipment deserve to be roasted. Simple. Moving on to a more positive one. Ben Lin. You need to have more views, man. Please give this man more views. Yeah, keep on watching. And that's also what I want to say for my 26th year on this planet. Keep on watching. Let me get a bit of water. Yeah, I'm doing this channel now for 2 years or something, and I'm really enjoying it. It already gave me a lot of opportunities, so I'm really thankful for that. The only people that I can be really thankful for are my viewers. It doesn't matter if they are haters or lovers. In the end, all that counts are the views and the watch time, because that's what YouTube likes. It's not me alone that is doing this. It's most of all you guys. So I really want to thank you all for having this journey with me on YouTube. And I hope that I can make a lot more videos in the future and also the next year. I've got a very freaky thing coming on which I want to concentrate for my 26th year on this planet. But I'm not telling you what it is yet. I will make a separate video about it after a few months, after I know what I'm doing. With that being said, thanks a lot for watching. If you want to do more for me and want to have more content, check out Patreon over here. You can support me starting with $1 per month. You will get early access to all my videos. I have priority answers to your questions. You can even get personal advice from me. I will also try to upload a video every week with an update talking about what's going on in the studio and what's going on with me. So check out Patreon. I'll link it over here. And if you're not want to support on Patreon, but want to see more videos, there's a random one over here. So click that and you will get another one of my videos. Thanks for watching this video, and I will see you guys again in the next video. Bye bye.